Of ICER Thiruvananthapuram. We welcome our Honorable Director, Professor J.N. Murthy, to deliver the welcome address and to introduce the chief guest of the day.
Esteemed chief guest, dear colleagues, staff members, students, I would like to extend warm greetings, and I wish to say Happy Foundation Day. Right. We all could wonder about what is the significance of this Foundation Day. Why do we celebrate? It is, as I said, celebration to sort of, we all, you know, come together, exist under one roof, and celebrate the very existence of our institute. That is the significance. And in doing so, we wish to reminisce the path that has led us to this point, how and in what ways we have traversed to get here, where do we stand today, what is the road ahead for us, what is the vision we have, what is the mission with which we would like to work? How do we want to strategize? And what are our goals? So come under one roof, celebrate the existence of the institute, set goals for ourselves, and in the process, resolve ourselves as to what and how we would like to proceed. And that is, to me, the significance of Foundation Day is. Let me look at where we have gotten here. And you all know the institute was founded in 2008. It's been about 11 years. Got started in the City Engineering College. And it's not long before that we moved ourselves entirely into this lovely habitat, what we call today as ICER TVM campus. In fact, we emphasize on having a permanent campus. And we do have a permanent campus. So it has taken for the institute a real long time, 8 years, hard efforts of several, my predecessors, the directors, to create the institute that we call today as ICER TVM. Right? And in 11 years, we have an existence and we have an identity for ourselves in the form of this beautiful ICER TVM. Let us reflect on, in the last 11 years, what are the strengths that we have gained in getting here, right? We have, if you talk about basically the academics for which the institution has been created for, we have a faculty strength of roughly about 65. The staff around, supporting staff, around 70. And the student strength, which began with a meager double-digit number in the formative years, we have now swelled that number to about 1,150, close to about 1,200. It's a large number. So this is where we have gotten to in the last 11 years. Let us look at the infrastructure that we have created, that has been created here. We do have capability to swell our student strength to about 2,000. The hostels that are going to be completed pretty soon will have a capacity for about 2,000, which means we are ready to expand in terms of the student strength and swell it to even 2,000. If you talk about the residences for the faculty and staff, We do have close to about 95 to 96 quarters. And presently, if I am right, I think if what I remember is right, I think 35 to 40 apartments have already been occupied. And in a few months' time, we will have the residences ready for occupation for another 60 or so. This is what, you know, we have gotten to. And of course, you all must have witnessed on the way to our academic building, there is a guest house that is coming up, almost close to completion, and has a capacity for about 58 rooms, right? And this is one, in fact, I talk about this to my colleagues as a jewel for our institute. If you want to really actively engage in academic activities, put together conferences, run workshops, and bring illuminaries, leaders in the scientific scene to our campus and engage in large-scale academic activities, I think the guest house is much needed. And I do not think about any other ICER having that capacity. We are really furnishing this in the best possible manner to give the unparalleled living ambience for the guests in our campus. We have a health center with 12 beds, and you know, I come from IIT, I envy this particular place, and even there we do not have the health center of the kind that you see here. Very nicely set up. We have a shopping complex, but it's going to take shape, rest assured. And academically, if you look at the research infrastructure, and I would like to say it is really enviable. Close to 300 crores has been spent on creating the infrastructure that you otherwise even do not witness in some of the very advanced institutions. This is what we have done in 11 years, right? So what has this translated into? I would like to say, well, the research output has begun to be seen from ICER-TVM in the world scene. Has begun to be seen, let me emphasize that. And our student graduates from the ICER-TVM are getting well-placed, accepted. Normally, the movement is towards the Western or European countries for higher education. And in the time that I have been here in the last 6 years, the way that I see is that our students are getting into respectable institutions for their higher education. As I said, research output is beginning to be seen, and the students are getting placed. This is the time for us to worry about basically accelerating the image for our institution, our progress, and putting the whole activity on a high trajectory of growth. Right? If we have to do that, what is it that we need? We need to worry about augmentation, and as I said, it's a foundation day. Let us basically look at what has gotten us here, what are our strengths, what are the lacunae, what is that we should do, and how should we be sort of focusing ourselves in the ensuing years is what I'm sort of trying to take you through. Speaking of the trajectory of growth, what is that we must do? Augmentation and the focus. What is it that we should focus on? Let us look at the academic development. I think we have been in existence for about 11 years. But if you look at the academic programs, we have stayed rooted with only four, namely physics, chemistry, mathematics, and biology. This is not done if we really want to enhance our visibility to the outside world. We need to academically expand. And since the time that I have joined here, this particular activity has been on. And in fact, even during the convocation, I did mention that we'll be getting started with the data science program. And along the same lines, we also have been working on an equivalent BSMS course in physics, chemistry, mathematics, and biology, which have, at the end of 5 years, in employable opportunities. and we still do not have a name for it, but rest assured, they're going to be kind of interdisciplinary programs in chemical sciences, interdisciplinary BSMS program in biology, in mathematics, and physics. So along with the data science programs, we will have a parallel applied science with interdisciplinarity that will have, at the end, a translational employment opportunities. We're going to start. The exercise is on, and in all likelihood, we will be launching this program no later than first or second week of January. So we need to expand academically. Yeah, the faculty. Well, for a student strength of about 1150, and 65 number is really small, and we need to expand the faculty strength, and we do have sanctions for this number, and the student community and the faculty community and even the staff, supporting staff. I'm sure all of you are aware of the fact that we put up the advertisement for faculty positions in our institute everywhere possible. And I would like to tell you that we have received astounding response to our call in some of the disciplines, namely physics, chemistry, and biology. And we are processing all the applications. In about 2-3 months' time, I think we should be making offers. And in about 5 to 6 months from now, we should be having new incumbents into our community, into our family. Of course, when we look at basically the faculty expansion, commensurate with the faculty number, we ought to have even the staff too. And we'll be looking to expand even the supporting staff as well. The constructions just got closed to a larger degree, but you probably know that we still have ongoing construction, which comprises a cluster of lecture hall complex, administrative building, and mathematics and humanities building. This cluster, the estimated expenditure for this cluster is to the tune of about 138 crores. And we are, I would say, about 30% through with these constructions, and these constructions will go on. If you leave that aside, I think the campus is full-fledged. But does not yet give the international appeal that the guests like Professor Desiraju, who is our chief guest, and the international community would like to see. And I keep saying this, our campus is blessed with the astounding natural beauty that sort of is around us. I think if we can blend some kind of a modernity with the extant beauty, I think our institute will be truly a world-class institute. This kind of beauty is non-existent for any ISO, but much needs to be done to modernize this and basically catapult this to enhance the visibility in the international level that one would like to see. Your campus has to be developed. And I would like to come to the student activities. Of course, the student community is aggrieved. I understand their pain. For an age group of 18 to about 25, 28, we do not have the infrastructure to take care of their day-to-day routine activities. We do not have a ground. We do not have the playgrounds for the student community. And since the day that I joined, I have been on it, but rain gods have not been kind to us, as you all know. Right? We did want to sort of, this is for the student community. We did want to bring up the cricket ground there and activated a lot of workforce, even brought loads and loads of the mud that was required to lay, for example, in the backside of the court there for the basketball. Unfortunately, all the mud that was procured has been washed away. And I'm sure with time to come, as the rains recede, we'll get quite active on that. And rest assured, we need to sort of create this infrastructure, and we will create. So these are the augmentation activities that we need to undertake. Of course, so academic vibrancy is important. One is education. Quality of the education has to be made better. And at the same time, in the campus, academic vibrancy has to be really increased. And this is one of the things I would like to delve a bit, because there is a larger student community. And in fact, before the function got started, we were a bit nervy that the anticipated crowd, I don't see. What is it that our students do in this small campus when they have nothing, but when there is a function being held, at least they could get here, right? Which was not the case. And some colleagues had to go and get them out. I think this inertia amongst the student community, I think, has to really disappear. I think the student community has to energize and energize us to sort of serve you better. I think for a call, I would like the request, you know, student community to respond to me better so that I take up more and more activities to the better of you. Conduct is one thing. I think, you know, Professor Gautam Desiraju loves this word. I picked up one-dimensional growth. And one-dimensional growth is not good. Yes, we are here for education. We are here for research. But that shouldn't become alone the only exercise. I think there is a lot that has to come from the student community for a campus that is taking shape in terms of contribution to the campus itself, in terms of sort of bringing the respect for the visitors that come to the campus. Just imagine I bring a very, very vibrant and very well-known scientist to the campus. If there is no sizable audience to receive the intellectual, that speaks volumes of where we stand. I think the student community should get out of this and look to basically sort of expand the horizon that is much needed today, right? This is where I would say the conduct has to change, the perception, the way, the outlook of the student community has to change. And I talked about the sports and cultural fests. Yet another matter for concern. Just in the preceding week, we had Anvesha Science Club activity. Right? If your lack of your response to an activity, what it would do is, there is always a bunch of students, about 30, 40 students, who would like to engage in this kind of activity. And it's much needed, because as an institution, we have to engage in outreach activities. There are about 40 or 50 students that come forward to sort of do this, and we declare a particular day as a non-instructional day in the hope that all the students become collectively a part of this exercise and in a manner that we can see that academic vibrancy, the outreach activity as a science club. But if I come here, there are about 400 students brought from outside, and except for the organizers, there is no other student. That saddens. What it does do is, next year if the student community comes back, well, why do I fund this? The student community I declare as a non-instructional day, and the students go and sleep there in the rooms. So I better not declare it as a non-instructional day, right? I think, which is where I said, I think the student community has become more, in a way, kind of inducing to the administration. Right? You should bring your energy to us so that we get activated. I would like to request the student community to sort of bring that culture in place whereby our campus reflects the academic vibrancy that I would like to see. We can go on. And quality of education and research. The research output has to get better and better for better perception by the outside world. And the teaching quality in the curriculum that we are teaching, we are already working on strengthening basically some of the loopholes in our curriculum. And starting from next semester, in fact, some of the courses that are going to be taught will have some revision. We have to build, I'm talking about basically the kind of focus and augmentation that we should worry about. We should worry about the alumni network. It's been about 11 years. We just had about 7th convocation. There's a sizable number of our alumni growing. And we need to sort of set this up. In fact, we have created this cell, and activity is on to collate every information about your predecessors from the graduates from this institution. We have to set, for better functioning, certain long-term goals, and we have to function with some mission. And what is the mission? I would like to sort of have a world-class, you know, institution that offers world-class holistic education with exposure to topical research. It's one of the objectives, and produce competent and sought-after graduates in the world scenario. That is the mission. Foster research in some niche areas and disciplines. I would like to identify them, whereby strengthen that particular research activity, whereby when you talk about this particular science, well, this is ICER-TVM for this. I'd like to identify some niche areas and strengthen the activity in those themes whereby ICER-TVM can be known for. I'd like to create ICER-TVM as a center for vibrant activity with education, top quality education, and frontline research. That is the mission. I think I said we have begun to do, we have been doing reasonably well, and I talked about the need to place ourselves on the, you know, the trajectory of growth. I think we have gotten us here. We have gotten ourselves to this particular point. In doing so, I think it's my pleasant duty, and I, you know, heartfelt way, I would like to acknowledge the services of the staff members who are pivotal in driving our institute, and they're indispensable and a constant force for us, which the faculty and the student community does not recognize. I would like to acknowledge their services, and of course, the PAY faculty who have been engaged in the discourse for the student community, which has allowed the student community to find placements, and they constitute pillars of our education system. And the 60-odd have contributed with their efforts, and I would like to acknowledge their services. And of course, the student community that has graduated from our institution and sort of gotten the message across to the world outside that the quality of the graduates from these institutions are respectable, that they could continue to hire the students from us. I think your predecessors, the student community, the alumni, must be acknowledged. Right? I think with that mission, and today, I would like to sort of resolve. I came here not with administrative background. I came here purely as an academician. It's my unfettered ambition to position this institution as the best institute for science education and research in India. Right? My faculty colleagues, dear students, and the staff members, let's resolve today to achieve this goal, strive harder and harder, come back next year on the same very foundation day, reassemble here to analyze and assess our progress, functioning, lacunae, and drawbacks. Let's resolve and re-resolve to stay focused for our ultimate mission to create the best institute for science education and research, and to feel at the end proud of being this fraternity. Let me wish you again, ICER-TVM, happy Foundation Day. Thank you very much. With that said, we have here amongst us an illuminary as a chief guest for today's function, Professor Gautam Desiraju, and I would like to invite him onto the dais, Professor Murthy. May I request Professor Murthy Srinivasula to sort of honor the chief guest to begin with. I'm really at loss of words to introduce Professor Gautam Radhakrishna Desiraju. I'm sure most of you would have read some very well-read articles of him in different fora. And of course, chemistry community, he's a pioneer, and I cannot think of any chemist in the country who has not heard about his name. In fact, as students, we would discuss about this particular fact, like if you go to the West or Europe and probably Japan or any other country, and pose this arbitrary question to any chemist, be it a student or somebody working in any area, can you think of one particular chemist who you can readily connect with in India? I bet they would not talk about anybody other than Professor Gautam Desiraju. I think such are his contributions in chemistry. And I may wish to share this particular information to you that he has actually been nominated for Nobel Prize. And if it does, I believe sincerely that will come through. And if it does, when it comes through, it'll be a big pride for us. And let me give you a brief introduction to him. In fact, I don't need any preparation if I am to introduce him. He was born in Madras, but received his education in St. Xavier's College in Mumbai. And with BS degree at the age of 20, of course, he went westward, as most of our graduates do, and pursued his PhD at the UIUC, University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. And within 4 years, he completed his PhD and then worked with Eastman Kodak Company as a research scientist for 2 years. At the age of 3 years, 6 months. And you can go backward and sort of worry about, he was born in 1952, and he joined in 1979 at the age of 27 years. PhD plus 3.5 years postdoc, only at the age of 27 years. And he joined as a faculty at the University of Hyderabad as a lecturer and became reader in 1984. And 89, I believe, became full professor. And that was when I was born as an academician, joining for PhD, 88. And in fact, the same very year that he became professor was when I ran into him in BRC. And I have had this privilege of knowing him today is 2019. So for the past 3 decades, I have known him more in the status of a student than anything else, he has been a role model for me. So let me go through the way that I know him. I continue to draw inspiration from him, motivation from him, strength from him. He is an incisive thinker, exemplary intellectual, passionate teacher. If you talk to people who have received the education in Hyderabad, you know, Central University, they would tell you what his teachings are like, and an outstanding scientist. So there are some, you know, I keep sort of dealing with him, fortunately, and some popular quotes. I will take about 5 minutes to introduce him. This is all about wisdom anyway. Right? So these popular quotes are like, when I joined in 1998 in Kanpur, so I happened to be an examiner for one of his PhD students at Central University of Hyderabad when I visited him. Of course, as an elderly person, he had a few words of advice to me. And one of them that he said is, "Murthy, you want to be a successful scientist in this country? And one advice to you is that it's difficult for you, difficult for anybody, but have as minimum number of friends as possible. Science requires time. If you get promiscuous in your friendship with everybody," I think promiscuous is a very bad word, but I would like to use that. Our Indian mindset is such, somebody comes and asks me to go for a coffee, you go, and immediately another friend comes, "Hey, come, chalo, aur ek bar." Then again you go. Right? This is our mentality, and this kills time, and science demands more time and you can't be successful. And every time if second friend came and called me for another coffee, I think I would remember Professor Desiraju. More friends, you can't be successful. And the second is a word of maturity, unmaturity. And maturity is something I think you have to cross at least 45 to know the maturity, what I'm going to say. He said, to me, maturity is something, if you think that you are matured, this is what he says, when you are comfortable with yourself, don't look for anybody's company. You're fine in your own world. Don't care not for what is around you. That's when you are mature. How many of us go for coffee alone? Invariably, we drag somebody. Okay, then you guys are already matured. Wonderful. Okay, then the third quote, eccentricity is an integral part of intellectualism. Right? Somebody is an outstanding scientist. He is involved in his own world. Maybe he is twisting his hands and probably giggling himself and laughing and talking to himself, which we seem to think that's a weird activity. But according to him, that's okay. That's when there's a sign of intellectualism. But don't start doing it in ICTVM as now, right now. Okay? As a scientist, he started at a time in 1979 with the kind of experience that he came back to the country, demanded the use of X-ray diffractometer. The X-ray diffractometer in those days, when the salaries were only 3,000 or 4,000 rupees, would cost about 30-35 lakhs. And such a kind of funding could simply be not thought of. He's one exemplary scientist, he said, who sort of has shown to the country research can indeed be done even without infrastructure. He lived of collaborations, international collaborations, and has done a world-class research and published a book in 1989 on what is called as a crystal engineering, which has become an area that is practiced world around. Is known for crystal engineering. Of course, monumental work on weak hydrogen bonds, and he published a second book. I would like to remember this. 79, he joined Central University. 1989, he released this book, published this book on crystal engineering. And that 1999, after a decade, again, he had a book on weak hydrogen bonds. These are monuments. These are monuments, really, in the area. I think I can keep talking about it, keep talking about him. I want to talk about his laurels. He's this fellow, that fellow, and he detests himself. But he did all that is needed to start a Gordon conference. I'm not sure how many of you have known about Gordon conference. This is a world-class series, which happened only in the United States. To get this conference started, it's not easy. You don't get even an invitation. Participation is only by invitation. If that be the case, for initiating an area and getting this conference started as a founder chair of that is a Herculean task. And he did that. In fact, he was the first Gordon chair of that particular conference today, which is practiced world round. Right? And he has been a president of International Union of Crystallography. That is no mean activity. And the first Indian to be honored so for 3 years. In that stature, he also conducted the International Union of Crystallography Congress in Hyderabad by bringing well over about 1,000 scientists from across the world. This was a big activity. The academic board of the Institute of Advanced Studies of the University of Bologna, Italy, has awarded the ISA Medal for Science in 2018 to Professor Gautam Desiraju. The ISA Medal for Science is the highest honor awarded by the Institute to scholars who are acknowledged worldwide for their scientific stature and broad impact of their research. According to him, the scientists, get me right, scientists owe it to the society to provide guidance, leadership, and above all, moral stature so that they become role models. It's not only just Shah Rukh Khan who is a role model or Salman Khan. You know, I think the scientists have a bigger role to play as a role models to the scientific community. I mean, to the community in general, in the society overall, right? We have to get into that particular issue, you know, so kind of a shoes. Who better than him to enlighten us about science education in our country? It's with absolute respect and joy that I invite Professor Gautam Radhakrishna Desiraju to deliver the Foundation Day lecture. Let's invite him.
Thank you, Professor Murthy, for these very kind words of introduction. I am happy to be here today in ISER Thiruvananthapuram on the occasion of your 11th Founders Day, and I extend my hearty greetings to the faculty, the staff, and above all to the students of this institution, who are our future investment into scientific activity of a very general sort in India. Now I want to now take you away from the temples of Jaipur and from this beautiful scenery of Kerala with this small rain and all that. And I want to take you to a far away place, long ago in time, 78 years ago in time. We are now in the month of March 1941. In a dark corner of Eastern Europe. 1941, March, Eastern Europe. It is under the heavy jackboot of the Nazi soldiers who had most of Europe in their control. You know, you students should read about World War II. I find there are two books. Since you are in the business of learning life's lessons, to learn about life, I found two books that influenced me above all. The first is a book from our own country, the Mahabharata. The second was Winston Churchill's 6-volume series on World War II. Because between the Mahabharata and World War II, you learn practically everything about human nature that you need to know. There's practically not much left. So here we are in Eastern Europe at a time, it's not like this cold, dark, everybody is scared. Father is scared of son, son is scared of father, husband is scared of wife, wife is scared of husband. Nobody knows who is the spy, who is the friend, who is the enemy. And anybody for real and imagined mistake can lose their lives also. That was the situation. And in such a situation, there was one Allied spy. He was hanging about in those terrible places. And he noticed that there was the movement of 3 full panzer divisions of the German Wehrmacht. Going from Bucharest to Krakow. A panzer division is a huge thing. It is like 12,000 men, tanks, infantry, artillery, the whole works. It was going in the train. It's a long distance in those days. It's like Thiruvananthapuram to Hyderabad. The other day we moved about, they say about 25,000 troops into Kashmir Valley. The whole country knew, even before the movement started. Already it was there in Twitter, everything. He noticed that this movement of this huge number of people was fully secret. It went all the way to Krakow, which is far to the north. Then something very strange happened. After 2 days, the whole lot came back from Krakow to Bucharest. Now, sounds crazy, and he relayed this information. How he got that information out of Europe into England, God alone knows. Churchill doesn't describe that. So when Churchill saw the news, and 2 days later, the Germans invaded Belgrade, which is a short distance from Bucharest. It is like going from Thiruvananthapuram to Trichur. So you are taking all these 36,000 fellows, tanks, artillery, everything, going up to Hyderabad, coming back after 2 days, and then going pusuk into Trichur and doing something. So what is going on? Most of us would have said it is some crazy, or we would have said that spy is not reliable or something. Churchill immediately sent a telegram to Stalin, and he said, "You be careful, the Germans are going to attack you soon." At that time, please remember that Russia and Germany were in a non-aggression pact. Stalin saw this telegram and he said, "This is crazy, this is a warmonger. He just imagines war everywhere where it is not there also." He threw it away. 3 months later, when the Germans came up to his neck like this, 1 million men were there. Hitler had amassed them in secret. Now, how did Churchill know just from this train going from Bucharest to Krakow and coming back to Bucharest and then invading Belgrade? What? I mean, doesn't seem to make any sense, no? How did he draw that conclusion? He did not know. Churchill did not know. But there was a secret visit made by one chap called Prince Paul of Yugoslavia to Berlin. Yugoslavia was always giving some trouble to Germany, bit like Kerala and the rest of India. Always some kinch going on. It's okay, part of the show. That's what makes India such a great country. Because all these shows are going on simultaneously in our country. But anyway, in war, I should not joke about it. Yugoslavia was giving problems, and he called this Prince Paul fellow and he said, "I will blow the smithereens out of you if you don't behave yourself. Delhi can't do that to Trivandrum today." But Hitler did like that. And that is why the train that went from Bucharest to Krakow was, it went to Krakow. Because Paul had told him that we will take care of Yugoslavia, don't worry. So, from Bucharest, all this was moved far to the north. 2 days later, when Paul returned back to Yugoslavia, Churchill did not know all this, that Paul was deposed. And there was a coup in Yugoslavia and they started fighting the Germans. And that is why the trains came back. The train that went to Krakow came back to Bucharest. Churchill did not know all this. But he guessed there must be some desperate reason why the Germans wanted to move the train to Krakow. Bucharest is not important, Krakow is important. And he said, why would they want to go so far to the north and almost close to the Russian border? The only reason is they want to attack Russia. So cut he got in him. Just like that he got the result. Correct answer he got. And then subsequent history also followed and so many things happened. But this is not a lecture on World War II. It is the role and duty of scientists, especially researchers, to read between the lines. I was in Krakow railway station about 20 years ago with an Indian chemist who is now rather well known in the country. So we were going to catch a train somewhere. And I told him, you know, what an interesting railway station this is. So he said, no, what happened? So I said, no, this is the story I told him. And even to this day, when I say something, this gentleman tells me, oh, it's that train to Krakow you're talking about. So it is, we have to look for the things between the lines. Last month, three mysterious announcements came from Shastri Bhavan in New Delhi. First announcement, look, you can ignore it. They said, in IIT, M.Tech fees are going to be increased to something. Okay. Again, some keech will happen. Are you going to increase everybody same? SCST should not have so much increase. This thing, that thing, all usual kind of arguments. People forgot. Within the same week, Shastri Bhavan again comes and tells us that after 3 years, IITs will give terminal BSCs for students who cannot cope up with something, terminal BSC, we are now going to introduce. 2 days later, again Shastri Bhavan, they said in IITs you will have to employ faculty with tenure track. That means after 5 years, 5.5 years, if you are no good, so bye-bye. So, too many trains are moving between Bucharest and Krakow here. In research, we have to look between the lines. He talked about weak hydrogen bonds and all. The things that are not said, the things that are not immediately seen, the things that are not immediately perceived, those who can see those signs are the ones who are successful in this research business. Everything you see, you know and you do and see, and that's all okay. That everybody, all of us can do it. Now, when I see these three signs from the great Shastri Bhavan, my conclusion, no, not very well, is that our government is flat out of money, broke. Paisa nahi hai. That is the only explanation that fits all these things. And suddenly so fast, everything, gut, coming. So we will be fools in ISER if we ignore all this and start making some typical Indian type argument, that is IIT, this is ISER, this is some third thing, this is Central University. No. Paisa nahi hai to paisa nahi hai. Bilkul nahi hai. So, I agree with your director. You have to do all these noble things. But we have to do it in a country that is changing very fast. Most of you were not born, and some of you, the faculty, many of them are too young to see what happened in 1991 when we were broke again. And the gold had to be put on one Air India plane. In those days, Air India was at least flying. It was taken to London. They said, physically, we want the gold in London. So after looting it us from us for 200 years, again, they looted again. The gold was sent to London so that we could get some immediate, some hand loan, just to tide over immediate few days. So, when the water came up to here, then and only then, they started saying some economic reforms, the great P.V. Narasimha Rao, the great Manmohan Singh, all the greater P. Chidambaram, all these people, it had to come up to here. Only a fool will wait until it comes up to here. So we did our reforms on gunpoint. Today we have to do educational reforms on gunpoint. Otherwise all these usual chakkar will go on. We are all very great and this thing, that thing. You know, China can write more papers, but the Indian papers are better. Kya hai yaar? Good is good, bad is bad. You know, you cut all the BS. Achcha hai, achcha nahi hai. All big committees to decide whether it is good or bad. No, he's okay, but actually his quality of thought is good. What quality of thought? Kuch kaam kiya ya nahi kiya isne? See, satyameva jayate vise. Actually, being truthful is the most easy and convenient route, because it will spare you a lot of humbug and all contortions and all, like some Harry Houdini you have to become. You know? No, not, life is not worth living. So today, you see, there is a serious money shortage, and the country also is at a cusp. Rightly or wrongly, whatever it is, you see, there is a great thing, and I have a great faith in the democratic system of elections that we have, which are still largely free and fair. And parliamentary democracy, I think it's good that we opted, and one of the greatest success stories of India after 1947 is that, contrary to the whole world opinion, the country survived and it actually became stronger with parliamentary democracy. They said that parliamentary democracy will not work in an uneducated country. You know, Rajaji even said that vote should only be given to graduates. That's all bunkum. By taking that bold plunge and giving everybody the vote, equal vote. See, this country has actually survived. Some of our brothers went over on the other side, and they have not survived. They tried all. I have been there to Pakistan 4 years ago, 5 years ago. They are the same like us. No difference. But they chose a slightly different route, and that route was a horrible route. So that's why today they are going to become 4 countries, 5 countries, nobody knows. See, we have survived and we have done okay, reasonably well. So given this democratic setup, the parliamentary election, all these things, even with all its imperfections, the country, one way or the other, whether you like it or not, has chosen a different path after 2014. You can't change that, and it's not going to go back. Kerala can still keep doing some kinch, but basically the whole country as such cannot go back into something. In history, if you read, it never goes back. It keeps moving forward. It may move forward in a bad way or an indirect way or whatever it is, but the question of reversing time, it doesn't happen. So in this new scenario, which is kind of aspirational India, we also have today, because of all the positive things done by the government over 70 years in terms of social upliftment and various things which had to be done. In fact, one of the main challenges in our country, no country has faced a challenge like this, that we had to do political reform, we have to do economic reform, we have to do social reform, things that took 200, 300 years in other countries, we have to do it in few years, 5 years. You know, we actually did about half of it almost, you know. We should not feel so bad. We Indians have a habit almost of self-criticism. Up to a point, it looks intellectual and sophisticated. After that, I tell you, especially you young people in Kerala, too much argumentation is no. You may think that you all are intellectual. You have got some friends in Bengal also. Kuch to kuch, you know, we have to do. See, I am a chemist. Chemistry, I was telling somebody in the morning, one of your department, a wonderfully practical subject, pragmatic. It is not a very sophisticated subject. Dr. Das is here, Prof. Murthy, all. Chemists, we are all very down to earth, straightforward people. We have something, all our reactions. The crux of chemistry really is that a chemical reaction can go to the most stable product, which is called the thermodynamic product. Or it goes to the kinetic product, which is the product which you get fastest. You are here sitting, you want one samosa or something, one fellow is selling it on a hut outside. It's a very bad samosa. Then there is one nice hotel in Trivandrum, you can go there. Very nice, best samosa in Kerala is there in that restaurant. Which one do you go for? Usually in chemistry you go for the samosa in the hut. Chemistry is that sort of subject, because most of the reactions, in fact all the big reactions, we go for the kinetic product, we go for the fastest thing. So this kind of excessive and abstruse theoretical treatment of political ideas and all that, that is like your thermodynamic product. It will come. But as chemists will tell you, you will always get the thermodynamic product after infinite time. Always. But then I should again quote your great Lenin to you, because Lenin himself said that in the long run we are all dead. A clever fellow, Lenin. In the long run we are all dead. So see, today in India, young person, he doesn't want to wait, or she doesn't want to wait so long that, you know, they're dead. We Indians will not elect governments who ask us to wait for so long that everybody will be dead. The governments also, you see, politicians, they are quite savvy people. They want to get the vote. They are also going for the kinetic product. Quickly, fadafat, if they can build a nice road to come to your campus. This person who gave the dance gave a nice illustration of the road to come here. Some vibration, simple harmonic motion it is to give you. Ye kya hai ye road hai kya kya? You got a big nice thing like a campus, but to come here, that is the rate determining step of the reaction. See, you know, you must pity your director. He's got to worry about all these things. He gave up a wonderfully attractive research program in Kanpur. I think sometimes he wonders why he came here. You know, we pure academics. See, now you know why I never went for an administrative position. I can nicely sit and start talking. No, but talk is, they say talk is cheap, but talk is not cheap. Everything costs money today. Everything costs money. I grew up in Bombay, a great city. The thing I learned there is money equals time, time equals money. In fact, today I get the feeling at the age of 67 that time is much more important than money. Much, much more important than money. And look here, our dear country doesn't have time. You teachers and students will have to work double fast, triple fast. All of you have to feel that you are in a corporate setup, which is called ISER Thiruvananthapuram. The director, the faculty, the non-teaching staff, the PhD students, the undergraduate students, all of you all are stakeholders in this corporation. You must get into that corporate idea. Even though, sorry, with due apologies, political persuasions of many people in this state don't like the word corporate, corporation, business, all these things. But this idea is very important because this country has now, one thing in science I learned about from CHO hydrogen bonding, actually people tell my work on crystal engineering and all that. I learned much more about stuff through CHO, not through crystal engineering so much. This CHO taught me something, that when the time for an idea has come, nothing can stop it. People like June Suter and George Jeffrey, Leslie Lazarowitz, whom I was privileged enough to meet last week in Israel. A number of people came. Professor Lazarowitz once told me, you know, because I told him, you've done so much work on CHO hydrogen bonding. He said, Gautam, you're very lucky. You were born when you were born. Because by the time you started doing some of the things, people were ready to accept the idea of CHO hydrogen bonding. He is 20 years older than me. He said, when I started doing this, people were not ready to accept that idea. So there is something called timing in science. I always say, it is better to be wrong at the right time than to be right at the wrong time. Time is all important. We have Navagrahas and I worship all of them. I even sing songs in praise of these Navagrahas because I was trained as a musician in my younger days. But the Navagraha that I worship the most is Shani. Because he is the Lord of time. And time is something, it's a horrible thing. It is inexorable. It kills you. That's why you get this Sade Sati, you know. If anybody will come and torture you. He means, it's not there's a person like a Shani riding on a crow and wearing a blue dress. There is no such thing like that. You have to think of it as the idea of time. It is said, Kala Chakra Beda Chit Prabhanam. That is what he has described. He is the person who can even break time. We mortals cannot break time, but you know, we are fighting against time all the time. The pun was intended. So see, you people, young people are very lucky because you are born at a time when this country is changing. It is changing very fast. The teacher should be sensitive to the needs of the students. These needs are changing. That old model of some research and doing, which became popular in the 1950s and 1960s in America, largely because there was so much money in America, so that you have the university, military, industrial complex that Eisenhower defined. There was so much money in America then that they can simply afford to push it into blue sky research. And the research that came out of it was so good, Bell Labs got 7 Nobel Prizes. Where you can think of a corporate lab, they called Bell Lab as a university without students. And you can't afford something like that today. So when that kind of money is there, you know, a lot of things will happen. Already by the 1980s, the US after Vietnam was running out of money. So what was true for physics and chemistry in the era of Bell Labs, DuPont, Xerox, General Electric, IBM, for physics and chemistry that super duper wealthy rich model worked. By the time it came to biology, which was more money intensive, by the 80s, when you had a company like Genentech and all that, then for the first time the researchers, individual researchers started, you know, companies were really started outsourcing their work to individuals. They could not afford anymore that huge setup. You know, they can't afford that. Even America can't afford it anymore. Now, slowly, you know, we are still coming. We have now reached the point. So you see, all you young people, even faculty and all, should realize that in this scenario, no scheme that is dependent completely on government money is going to be viable. Firstly, there is no government money. So just to go and say, you know, I've got this brilliant idea, it actually is not so brilliant. It is the thing that your postdoc mentor in Germany was doing, and you change some methyl to ethyl, and then you are coming and trying to reproduce that here. Not so brilliant. But somehow you get a feeling, huh, it is like that nicely, I can eat apple strudel. So, you know, that kind of dreaming you can't do. There is no apple strudel here, there is only adapratthaman. And you better learn to enjoy adapratthaman and forget about the apple strudel. And we should take pride in that adapratthaman. Because that is us, that is what this, you know, dancer just said. That spirituality, you know, that connects the artist with the ultimate reality. That is a unique feature of our country. You take that away, you don't have India. You just have some B-grade Germany or some C-grade America. So to deny that spirituality in any religion, it is not a matter of this religion or that religion or something. If you deny that, you deny your very Indianness. And as I was telling one of the departments I met this morning, every country, Germany, America, Japan, England, they've got strengths, they've got weaknesses. Your director talked about strength and lacunae, he said. I'll say weakness. These successful, clever countries capitalize on their strengths and they hide their weaknesses. We are much better country than them. Till 1800, the GDP of India plus China was half the world GDP. We are a very rich country. Only in a rich country you can write something like Vedas and have the Sanskrit language. Unless the country is very rich, it will not produce a language like Sanskrit. We are a very rich country. We got looted because we are stupid, you know, somewhere. People found some weakness in our thing and then brought us down. Now, the foreign countries, the advanced countries, they know how to capitalize on their strengths. We know how to capitalize on our weaknesses. Every time something happens, kin. We are always fighting with each other about stupid things. You fight about big things, I say. For big things, it's worth fighting about. Things that are worth fighting about, we don't fight. Things that are not worth fighting about, we fight. Huh? This should be avoided because this is not. See, okay, 70 years, 70 saal to ho gaya. We can't go on saying, you know, everything, you cannot go on blaming the British for everything. They came, they had a good fun, they saw everything, they looted and they went. Suppose I was put in that position, I will also loot like them. If you are dealing with people who are so stupid. Hey, dog eat dog, you know, you can't go on blaming them and think, no, no, but this, but that, and this thing. It becomes a sort of a reductio ad absurdum. Which is where, you know, we really find ourselves. So when things have changed, today the foreign countries also cannot accept you people in permanent jobs. This was happening in those days when America was very rich. So the fellow, Presidency College, IIT Kanpur, Columbia, some Genentech, like that, he'll go like that. Afterwards he'll get Nobel Prize also like Abhijit Banerjee. That is okay, that is different. That is America, that's not India. All these people who are saying Abhijit Banerjee, Indian Nobel Prize, Bengali Nobel Prize. This country has failed people like that by not giving them. Clearly, he's a very bright man. Given the right system, he could go and get Nobel Prize. If you put them in a bad system, even the fellow who can get Nobel Prize, he will get one Kachra Prize, like which are all our Indian awards, and so many are there. All rubbish awards, zero. No, I am fellow, he said, of all the academies of India and all that. You know what I did? I got fed up of receiving all. I put all the academies on spam. I don't get any emails anymore. Very easy, computer just khadak like that, over. Happy I am, because I don't have to listen to all this nonsense. Something again, at least he said Mushika, at least it is taking Ganesha. These Mushikas just, that's all, nothing, zero. Some committee, some big thing, the chairman sitting. Again, as I say, he's good, student is good, good, bad, bad. Should not be scared. To make a professional judgment with a politeness. We confuse professional judgments with personal things. You can tell somebody, as Churchill himself said, when you're going to kill a man, it costs nothing to be polite. You know, I know we love to hate Churchill in India, but still, he said a few clever things. People say he didn't really say them, his speechwriter said them, something they say, but it doesn't matter. So we should learn to say impolite things in polite ways. Sometimes you may actually be helping a student or a faculty colleague or something to tell him or her the truth bluntly. I once had an MSc student. He was very keen to do PhD with me. So then he was pestering me a lot, and frankly I felt that at least he might be doing good for somebody, but he will not suit. So I said, look, as he said very, very wisely, the dancer, he's talked about Hindi and he said, you cannot emote in English. Once you start translating it to English, you know, we lose the gist of it. He said Hindi, but I'll say for any Indian language. We can emote in an Indian language. You can express things in Malayalam which you cannot express in English. The subtlety is different, the culture we understand. I spoke to him in Telugu. I said, look here, I don't think PhD is meant for you. His response was very strange. He smiled at me and he said, yes, I know that. Then he said, thank you for telling me that. I was beginning to have some doubts. Then he did a lot of agitations, student agitations he did. He got rusticated, then he came back. Then he became friendly with one of my colleagues who was a very kind person. He did PhD with him. Now he's actually professor in Gujarat University. So you see, there is a saint in every sinner and a sinner in every saint. When you're teachers, you please be worrying about the students as individuals. Students are not just some amorphous commodities who just come and then something, some great book, grading something, this batch, that batch. No, each student is an individual. The individuality of each and every student must be respected by the teacher. Otherwise, you are not a teacher. You can be some policeman or something. And as I said, this corporate feeling, I said Trivandrum, you should feel that, it was something great. My years in I said Trivandrum were the best in my life. Many students from Hyderabad have come and told me that. I've even forgotten, so many students I have taught. They come back, suddenly they tell me, they smile. Then I know that they must have been a former student. I am embarrassed that I don't remember their names, faces. They say, sir, the years in Hyderabad were the best time. People should come back. He spoke about alumni. They should come back and feel like that the years in I said Trivandrum were the best. How can they be the best? If all of you stakeholders, teachers, students, everything, non-teaching staff, everybody should feel part of a combined experiment. And as I said once again, the times in which you all are working are very different from the late 70s when I entered the academic life. Because the whole atmosphere is much more equitable, much more Catholic, much more open, much more accommodative, and very much more free. It is not feudal anymore. The whole academic system is no more feudal. Some fellow sitting in some Pune or Bangalore or Jaipur or something, deciding the fate of the whole country. This not can't be done anymore. Wo model to khatam ho gaya. The public won't accept it, you know. Public won't accept it. It's not a question that, you know, because as I said, we are a liberal democracy at the end of the day. So that thing, that chela, something, godfather, then chota godfathers, then chota godfathers, it won't work. Because there are too many institutions, there are too many things. I am seeing the paper from Amity University, I am seeing good papers from Shivanadar, I am seeing from Shastra University, I am seeing from Velur Institute, I am seeing from SRM. That SRM is putting a lot of money. They are telling, if you get a paper in JAX, I'll give you 5 lakhs or something. Good, give. You get the paper. Then the fellow in IIT Kanpur will feel nervous. Then he'll say, I'll join SRM, I'll get 5 lakhs also. Then there's no harm. What is that? 5 lakhs even I will take. If somebody gives me 5 lakhs, I will take. So long as it is legal. You know? Illegal. You can't. It's dishonest, illegal and all, you can't take. Legally, if somebody gives me 5 lakhs, I will take. You know, so you people are living in times of change. And teachers, you need to concentrate more on the all-round growth of students. Jnanam vijnana sahitam. Knowledge must lead smoothly into wisdom. And he said 45 or something. I don't think one has to grow old to become wise. You can be quite wise when you are quite young. If you are seeing things and you are seeing things openly, the balance is of crucial importance in a place like Isar. Because to the extent that a very poor country can manage, you have been given an excellent ambience to do teaching, research, education, the whole enterprise called Vidya. And Vidya again, education, knowledge, they are all very poor English translations of the word Vidya. Because Vidya means tapas. Tapas itself is Swadhyaya plus Pravachana. So a teacher who simply learns for himself and is unable to communicate is no use. He is not a researcher. The Pravachana part is very important. Some fellows I know, they say, no, I'm working on that fabulous paper which I'm going to put in Nature. So there, I'm going to. He's been saying that for the last 30 years. People have made a career of doing like this. You know, if I only had that equipment, I could write that paper in and get it into Nature. But I don't have that equipment, you see. So therefore, DST should give me some 10 crores or so. Why DST will give you one thappad? Please see, they also have got, you see, you cannot always go on blaming Shastri Bhavan and Vigyan Bhavan and Technology Bhavan. All those Bhavans, you cannot blame them indefinitely. It's just like us blaming the British. If you get a particular feeling that I don't like Delhi or something, I have learned to endure Delhi. Delhi, you go there either to ask for money or get money, give money. Only two reasons for going to Delhi. Otherwise, there is no other third reason to go, unless you are some interesting type. So, you see, they also have problems. They cannot go on giving money to everybody just because he has some idea. And there is no money. I can tell you, there is no money. So, please, I don't want to use a bad word like warning signal or something. But have your eyes open. Be aware of the fact that the times are different. They are not what they used to be. So anybody who had that comfortable idea that somehow whatever I was going on before, I'll also do like that, and it's something like that. If it is not like this, it will become like that. And if it is not like that, some third thing will happen. It is all okay. it will not be okay. This is what the simple thing I want to tell you at the end of my lecture. Just by doing incremental things, certainly I gave you a guarantee it will not be okay. And you will not even be able to maintain at your level, you will come down. You will come down to the point where you actually start seeing physical and economic suffering. Either in your research work or in, and students also please remember, foreign countries are not willing to absorb you anymore. All that is out. Teachers must have a forward-looking curriculum that gives employment opportunity at every stage. A BS, MS student product should get a job. PhD should not become compulsory to get a job. Should not. And if a BS, MS student is not getting a job, but the IIT student is getting a job, giving 50, 60, 70,000 rupees a month, the fault is exclusively with the teachers, nobody else. Because all students are bright students. I have never seen a bad student in my life. I have seen lots of bad teachers. Student, you know, why should student come here? Why should student waste his or her time to come here? You tell me, frankly, teachers. Why should he or she come here at all in the first place? You want some income? No, his fellow is passing some other exam, he is getting a job at 22, 23, IAS officer, bank officer, this officer, that officer. Something they are getting. Most young Indians, I find, want a job in preferably in their home state and near the place where they grew up, where they are familiar. Something you do PhD, then you go to some Yokohama, then you go here, Seattle, here and there, like a gypsy. Then come back, then go on applying for jobs, hundreds of jobs, no jobs. Then after you get the job, then sitting, I want this award, that award, this thing, so many things. Nothing, zero. Finally, the work is forgotten, quality is forgotten. Today we don't have even quality or quantity, both are not there. So if I may be somewhat harsh on the teachers, which I am being, it is because a place like ICER puts an onerous responsibility on the teaching community. You have to do the work of two people, three people, four people even. It's a question of building a confidence, because you teachers are the interface on one side with the students for whom this place has been set up, and on the other side with the government, who has been giving you taxpayers' money to indulge your intellectual fantasies. At least in CSR, if you go, they'll do and danda and say, you know, do work on this project. See, you have been given that liberty to work on things of your liking. So that liking has to synchronize and mesh with what is important for this country. Whether it is to train a student, whether to make a student give a job, whether to go, see, you cannot give an industrial process or project. I am told many of the students in ICER, Trivandrum, are from Kerala. Then you should go to schools, primary schools, small places in remote places. The students themselves can go and start teaching in those schools as part of the project. And that should be given, Professor Murthy, credit in the credit system. It should not be something that you put as an extra and you can do it in your free time or something. Because look, for each one of you who is here, there are 100 people who could not come in here. There are people who don't have money to go to school. There are schools with a single blackboard. I have seen a school, the single blackboard, there are two classes on both sides. Each teacher is saying something on either side of the blackboard. They don't have money to put a second blackboard. In Kerala, you have an advantage because the school education here is one of the best in the country. It's really good. One of the questions I ask always when I visit Kerala is, how is it that a state that is so good in school education, not making its mark in higher education and research? I don't talk about the large number of very talented Malayalis who are working elsewhere in India. Why are they not able to do it in Kerala? Calicut University, MG University, These are all places that will benefit if a good PhD from ISET Trivandrum goes as a teaching person there. China has gone through that phase where PhDs of the top institutions went as research cum teaching in the second tier and third tier places. And this is clearly mentioned in the new education policy 2019. I would advise all teachers to download a copy of this and read it carefully, cover to cover, all 489 pages of it. It's a good document. I mean, it's like a big wish list. So many things are there, all good things are there. Like what the Americans will say, mother, flag and apple pie. You can't criticize what is in that NEP 2019. It doesn't tell how you are going to do it. But by the by, let me tell you that new education policy does say that we are going to have tenure track system in higher education. So it is not that Shastri Bhavan did not give us notice of their intentions are clear. And one thing I have noticed about these new fellows who came after 2014, whatever they say they will do, generally they seem to be end up doing it. They're taking some time to do it, but it is not like previous regimes who would say so many things and do nothing. You may agree with them, you may not agree with them. That is entirely different. But I have now learned that whatever the guys are saying, better listen to them, because the chances are bright that they will end up doing it. It is tucked away in a small corner of these 500 pages. Tenure track policy will be introduced or something. So you have to be careful. No? Before you vote somebody, you should be careful whom you are voting for. These guys seem to be a little serious about doing what they say they will do. I am not making any pronouncements on whether what they are saying is correct or wrong and all that, because I don't want to get into a political discussion out here. But this is what I meant when I said, and anyway, so many people have voted for them. That means whatever they are doing, them so many people want. And when so many people want something, then that's all of us. You know, you can't say somebody else, some strange person, some phantom has gone and voted for those fellows in Delhi and we are all different and nahi chalega. So let me conclude then that your education should also bring humility. Gita says, Vidya Vinaya Sampanne. The Vidya without that Vinayam, useless. All these gentler lessons of education can only arise in a gentle country like India. Be proud that you are Indians. Be proud that you are in an institution that is saying Indian institute. That Indian word is. You know. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Does anyone from the audience have any questions?
Yeah, please. I mean, give him the mic so that everybody can hear the question.
Thank you for the very enlightening lecture, sir. So, you mentioned that in 1991, when we were going through this economic downturn, we went through some stopgap measures and we basically opened our closed economy. That's how we escaped. In this juncture of change, what do you think we can do as a nation to, you know, tide over this?
To tide over what?
This, you know, uncertainty in what's going to happen, like particularly in funding for research. And
I think government has a limited amount of money. It will fund those areas in which you are able to establish even indirectly, because you are an institution of fundamental research. So I am not asking for a direct connection. At least an indirect connection between what you are doing and a problem of national interest. Like this morning, I interacted with members of your biology department, and a young lady was doing work on these bees, you know, honey bees. I saw some honey bee nest also in some of the buildings here, big ones. So one of the crises about this bees problem is that people fear that the whole bee population of the world itself is going to be extinct. And she pointed out that we don't have proper data. Then I was thinking, I told her about what your director said about the efforts in big data which you all are doing. So if somebody can do a really reliable study on the bee population of India, that would be something where the biology and the big data enterprise and the multidisciplinary thing all come together. This is the sort of research that would get the highest priority in funding from cash-starved places like DST and so on. And this also brings me to the other point, that in the old days when we were educated, we had narrow specializations, which prompted me to use that phrase which your director used, is one-dimensional people. Today's young people need to be multidimensional, because the kinds of job opportunities, the kind of education you get should be such that you can get jobs in this sector. And that will happen in a multi-dimensional kind of a teaching, where people should be equally comfortable with big data, with honeybees, with everything, all. And if you get expertise with a broad variety of things, then you can actually take up research anywhere. Professor Murthy will tell you that some of my papers, you know, cover from many branches of chemistry, organic, structural, inorganic, physical, so many places it covers. It's just that, you know, I kept my mind open, because finally it's the same chemistry only. It is not, you know, I'm only doing organic chemistry. No, I'm only doing synthetic organic chemistry. No, I'm only doing synthetic organic chemistry to make five-membered carbocyclic rings. I won't make heterocycles. Heterocycles is below my level. That sort of an attitude which used to be there before, that will not be there. You should not have that attitude in the teaching program also. So you have to gear it up with, you are living in a wonderful ecological diversity system here. Some people are doing work on biodiversity. It must link directly to Western Ghats, which is one of the most fascinating biodiversity regions of the world. And you know what, remember what I said about we should bank on our strengths and not on our weaknesses. We should not go and study biodiversity in some remote Japanese island, because you have, finally you will need the same kind of expertise to do either Japanese island or just 2 miles from here in this forest. But you've got to do research on biodiversity of this area, which is so good that the foreign expert from Japan comes and he can learn something new from your research here. We must get to a stage when our quality is so high that people will come on their own to come and see us. We don't have to go and see them. No way. We should not go. If you look at the history of Japan, Japan closed itself to foreigners about 200 years ago for a long period of time. And they developed within themselves. China went through a similar phase 100 years later. Sometimes I feel that kind of an isolation may actually even help us in a certain way. That was a drastic thing and it cannot be done in the modern world. But we cannot do it physically, but we should try to do it intellectually and mentally, so that again something that is essentially Indian comes out. The dancer that we saw is producing a quality item. It doesn't, none of us know how to do Kathak dancing, but we can recognize the quality, no? Nobody will say that it is not, it's of a poor quality thing that he did. Nobody will say here. So like that, when we do a scientific paper, we write something, you don't have to go and tell somebody, hey, I did this, it's so great, I am so great. He will know automatically by reading the paper that it is great. And so the challenge for people in ICER is to take something which is fundamentally very important and make that connection to India. It can be very broad. You see, we've got problems like environment, water, climate change, ecology. This connects physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics. It connects all your four main disciplines. In interesting ways, the teacher doesn't have to be expert. Teacher just has to be able to tell the student, this is the huge world that is open to you. Each student, based on his or her aptitude, will take up some areas. That is what we should do. It has to be more, I'm sorry to use this overused word, holistic. But it's a very good word, you know, you should, the whole education thing, it should go into that line. And when it goes into that line, you will not have problems from DST, DBT to get funding. Please.
Thank you, sir. A lot of research is done through public funding. But researchers want to publish their results in high-tier journals like Nature and Elsevier that have a paywall to access their articles. So the public is faced by a double whammy. They have to pay for the research, and they also have to pay for the results of that research. Can you offer any solutions that can improve the situation?
You are absolutely correct. This is very unfair and, in fact, criminal to charge people two times for the same thing. And I think open access is the only way to the future. And they have already made great progress on this in Europe. And I do believe that DST must stop pussyfooting some plan C, plan B, something Vijay Raghavan is talking all the time. Nothing happens. It just gets lost in some committee room in Delhi. DST can give a clear policy, saying that any project which you give, 15% will go only to open access fees, and say that that fee cannot be transferred to some other fund. Take the fee for open access and then take a jaunt to Germany or something. No. That open access can be only used for open access. I quite agree with you that, especially in a poor country where the government is paying for your research, nobody should have to pay. The other solution which I have found in my own career is that it doesn't matter so much which journal you publish. And I found something very interesting. The quality of a paper may not correlate with the impact factor of the journal where it is published. May not. But a quality of the paper always is correlated directly to the impact factor of the journal where the paper is cited. A good paper, it can be published in any journal. If it is good, it will be cited in a journal that has a high impact factor. That may be a better measure for DST to use than to simply blindly see, oh, he's written a paper in PhysRev Letters, so he must be a genius. Oh, he got a paper in JAX last month, he has to be a genius. No. At least in chemistry, I am on the editorial boards of many of these journals, so I saw the situation from the other side. Most papers by Indian authors in high-impact chemistry journals are the least cited in that journal. It is bringing down the impact factor of that journal. So that is why editors are always looking carefully at papers from India. And why do the Indian papers get accepted in high-impact journals? Some big fellow will be there in America or England or something. He will be doing something, some great work. And now this guy is there in India. Either he was his postdoc or doesn't matter. He doesn't have to be also. He could be just working in that area. So he writes a nice paper which is technically quite competent. And it will go to some of these big names abroad for refereeing. So this guy, he'll say, oh, this is so nice, you know, this fellow from India. Oh, do you know, he has commented favorably about my model and so on. So the referee himself is in a very pleasant mindset. Also, there is a bit of, I would say, racism. You know, this noblesse oblige. Oh, India, some fellow. So he's actually doing something very nice, very nice. He will accept the paper. So that is why the paper gets accepted, but it doesn't get cited. Because any other third fellow, some ex coming from some place, he will only cite that first big boss's paper. He will not cite the Indian's paper. You go, you look at all the people from India who have now started publishing in JAK, Sangevante, all these, Nature, Chemistry and all. See how many times those papers got cited. A paper that is published, you know, it is like, you know, you have put something in a very expensive museum, but nobody goes to see that particular exhibit. They are going to see some other thing, some crown or something. They are going to see something else. They are not coming to see that particular exhibit. So you put your exhibit, but nobody wants to see it. So it is for an Indian to put a controversial, crazy sort of a thing in a high impact journal. That is very difficult. Because then you are saying, hey, look, I am saying something that you guys are not saying. You better read what I have written. And I believe that is how assessing people also should look at these papers. Instead of just going crazy, ha, Jacks mein likha hai, Angevante mein likha hai. Most of the people in the committee don't understand the paper anyway. Some Jacks they have heard, some word like Jacks they have heard. Some Angevante they heard, they pronounce it all wrong also. Some Angi, Vanti, something they say. Funny things they'll say. So Aisa to, you know, we be careful. So your question is very good. No, we should not go to private journals published by private fellows. I refuse to even referee for these journals. You know, I say that, sorry, unless you change your policies on open access and journal prices, Springer, Elsevier, all these fellows, I don't even referee for them.
So, what should be the role of scientists in this community now? And we are also like a pile of accumulation of papers has been published everywhere, but it has not been like practically it is not coming into the world. I think so. What should be the solution for this?
Two different questions. Role of scientists, I shouldn't, you know, trumpet my own papers, but Professor Murthy has referred to one of my recent papers. I think you should go and have a look at that. It is in Angevante, by the way, and it is about called Science and Society. So you read that. There I have written that scientists have a duty to society and society has a duty to scientists. Both. Excuse me? You have sent it to them. Right, director says that he has sent it to all of you. So, scientists must lead the society. Scientists should not follow society. And many scientists in leading countries abroad lead society. Their opinions are taken seriously by the politicians. In India, the scientists are very scared. They go on asking, what did the minister think? And so based on what they feel the minister is thinking, they write something or they tell in a certain way. Actually, you know, most of the time minister may not be feeling like that. It is just that, see, so the whole thing becomes kind of little funny. That is your first point. Second point is this duplication of papers. There I think natural selection will come into play. Because there is a lot of thing being written, you know, Roald Hoffman said once that you can get any junk published in some journal of the world. So getting something published is not the issue. The real issue today, even for serious researchers and good papers, is getting somebody to read your published paper. People don't have time. They say they don't have time. They don't have time. Because all the time they're with some cell phone doing some kit. You cannot do research with that, you know, that cell phone. I found one day one student in IISc doing like this. Then I heard it is a new game among the students that they can send text messages with the cell phone in the pocket or something. I hope that sport has not taken charge here. IISc, we are always better than others. So I think the natural selection, the junk papers nobody will read after some time. They will also get tired. And I think UGC has also done some good things, that because these pirated journals has become such a problem now, that they have removed some restrictions on this, how many papers you have to write. See, this other thing also, Murthy, this is that PhD student has to get one paper, two papers before PhD and all. I think we have to relook at some of these things. It's not, present system is not okay.
I would now like to call upon Sage, our director, Professor J.N. Murthy, to felicitate our chief guest. Now invite Professor Murthy Srinivasula to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening, everyone. What a fantastic afternoon we had here. Very rarely we get a chance to see one of the best artists performing on the stage, and also finest speaker or academician, and both in one single afternoon. I have never had this experience before. This is the time for me to give vote of thanks. After hearing Professor Desiraju, I cannot express my gratitude in words, but nonetheless we have to say a few words for the formality's sake. And to be formal, Professor Murthy, our director, Professor Gautam Desiraju, our esteemed colleagues, administrative staff and students. I deem it great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of the entire ICERTVM to a great scholar, academician and thinker of our time, Professor Desiraj. Thank you very much, sir. So I have noted few of the sane advices that he has given, not only the students, I think it also works most of us. Learn from history and read between the lines, and I say, and importance of time. Doing right thing at the right time. Ability to see ahead of the curve. Prepare yourself for changing times. Become stakeholders of entire ICERTVM. For teachers, focusing on the importance of socially relevant science and the employability of our students. Well taken, sir, and we will do our best. And probably most of us always interact with the students, try to tell them what we think is the right thing. One of the things, as Professor Desiraju was mentioning, seeing ahead the curve, one of the things Churchill said, I quote here, the universities were one of the most important by means by which we could cherish freedom, freedom of thought, freedom of concern, freedom of expression, and freedom to hope. Sir just mentioned 2014, I did not go beyond that. I hope there is a we will continue to enjoy the freedoms that we have been enjoying for the last 70 years in future also. And as an academician and great thinker, he can help us. There is a lot of apprehension all over India regarding this matter. I was hoping he would touch on it, but probably in some other time. I felt it very personal because what Professor Desiraju was mentioning, it is very important to have the freedom. And we have been looted for hundreds of years precisely because we were unable to stand up or being quiet. And that's what happened not only in India, it happened during Nazi Germany time. People were taken, families were taken, millions of people were taken one after the other. And one more thing, I am quite confident being an Indian, lived abroad for some time and came back, we don't have that situation here. I'm quite confident about it. By very nature of our culture, I do not see, but at least as an academician, we all talk whether we'll be able to do that collectively is a different question. But nonetheless, it is something important which is, I am sure, concerning most of us, including students. Next, on Foundation Day is the occasion when ISRTVM publicly proclaims its commitment to enduring benefits of higher education to its national and global mission and to unfettered pursuit of scholarly inquiry. It is also the occasion to remember all the people who helped to build the institution so far, including all the directors, registrars, deans, HODs, faculty, students, to reach where we are now. I particularly thank Professor Murthy for his untiring efforts for the last 6 months to make the campus more vibrant. The successful culmination of this program owes much to the guidance and support of our director, and I thank him for the same. I also thank all the distinguished invitees present here for accepting our invitation, which included our emeritus professors and their families. Also extend my thanks to Spikmake and all the artists for their wonderful program, and also Dr. Rajiv Kini for arranging or coordinating the program. Well, an event like this cannot happen overnight. The wheels start rolling weeks ago. It requires planning and a bird's eye for details. We have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team led by Dr. Utpal Manna, of very motivated and dedicated colleagues, both faculty and staff, who know their job and are result-oriented. I thank all of them. I cannot thank everyone enough for their involvement and their willingness to take on the completion of tasks beyond their comfort zones. We also thank members of the faculty, administrative staff for their efforts in successfully organizing this Foundation Day lecture. Thank you all once again. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That marks the end of the Foundation Day programs. We sincerely thank each and every one of you who made this event a grand success.